story. It is a story about growth on several levels. As you know, as they said even in Twin Peaks, things are not always what they seem to be. And what is quite interesting is that it's a real story. Okay. So, like any story, I should start with once upon a time, not so many years ago, like six years ago, there came a big badass monster, the financial and economical crisis. Yes, it came with a bang, PowerPoint. Of course, this came as a tremendous shock, especially here in Romania. We were, after 8 years of booming economy, with its normal and related excesses. So, when this came, it shocked a lot of markets. The market that I'm talking about, mainly, is the automotive market, which, just imagine, now, the PowerPoint, it went like this. From 2008, when it was at around 300,000 units sold, up to last year, it declined by six times. Six times for a big market, up to 50,000 vehicles. Just imagine that. Over the same period, we managed to grow seven times. How was that, and in what sector? It's a sector that actually is related to this market. It's called the rental, automotive rental sector. Like the financial sector as well is related to this market, it was severely hit. Like Razvan said, it's a sector that where the big players make the rules. It's only normal because it requires a lot of capital, a lot of knowledge, a very strong brand, and good old useful systems to put all this into practice. It's all about the systems and the capital and the knowledge. It's a big boys club. And it's like this all over the world. Okay. On this sector, just imagine also, there are the big players, there are some small players. Many of them there were. And they were very shocked in 2009 when half of the market disappears. What do? You start to fight. So they started to fight among each other. It was a huge price war. Okay, we have all this not so rosy scenario. How did we do it? How did we manage a small, recently incorporated, we were incorporated in 2006, company from up north in Pietra Neamț. How did we manage to grow in all this difficult time? Of course, there is the classical explanation. In business, the main explanation is about strategy. Okay, what was the strategy? And it's a very valid talk. We can talk about strategy for a lot of time. So what were our main key points about our strategy? What did we do that the others did not do? One is that something that was a luck, actually, that initially our business was based on a low-cost model, like Ryanair and all that. We put this into practice in this sector and nobody else has thought about it. So, of course, this allowed us to address the newly popped-up needs of companies for efficiency, for cutting costs. So this was a very valid strategical point. Another one is about the opportunities that you have in a crisis. In a crisis, you can invest at lower costs. You can do lots of things, of course, if you are crazy or courageous enough to do it. Just think of the demand. Okay, that's the best example in Romania for courageous people that took the opportunities during a crisis. Another one is related to the fact that we were and still are an entrepreneurial company, entrepreneurial driven, and especially the main thing that helped us in this entrepreneurial drive was the adaptability. I don't know how many of you have read the last book from Taleb, which is called Anti-Fragile, but he's quite convincing about how an entrepreneur can be much more solid, much more anti-fragile than a bank. Why is that? Because he can adapt. So, of course, we had this opportunity, we put it into practice, and it took us a very, very short time span. In a few months, we completely reshuffled our strategy. We went from a retail business to consumer, to business, with the same people. So, of course, there are all these directions, strategy, and we can go on and on. There are others. But the main focus for the rest of my presentation, for the rest part of it, is not about this. It's not about strategy. Is about what allows this strategy to be put into practice. You can have the best strategy. You can even buy it from a consultant. But the best strategy, the best part of the strategy, the most important part of the strategy is its implementation, its execution. And a lot of people say this, and they stop there. But they don't think about not how you are going to do it, but who is going to do it. It's mainly a talk about the people, about the organizational culture that allows you to put this into practice. And I chose a very specific, it might seem a trivial part of this culture, but for us it's a very important one, and you'll see what I'm talking about. I'm going to firstly speak to you about books. Yes, as simple as that, books. Why books? We are talking about growing, about personal growth. Okay. How do you do that? We really think, and we've seen this in practice with hundreds of people involved, that books are probably the main instrument for personal growth. But it's not enough to read them. Of course, it's nice. Read what kind of books? Business books are related, you can recommend. But it's not enough to read them, like most of the people do. In the company, in an organization, the most important thing is what do you do after you read them? And also how you read them. So it's about taking some useful things out of them and putting it into practice. Okay. So the most important part in our system about books is not that we just recommend it, that we think of it, it's a value of growth, of personal growth, is how we do it, actually. How do we actually freaking do it? It's not easy, it's clear. But up far we've been quite successful. A few things about how we do it. One is about who is doing it, about recruiting the right people. Okay. So when we recruit, there is a saying that I saw recently, say, Nordstrom from the United States, a big guru of customer excellences, a practical one, he said that I can hire nice people and train them to be salesmen, but I cannot hire salesmen and train them to be nice. So the tagline here, and we really think that this is the way in our culture, is to hire for attitude and then train for skill. So that's what they do. We try to find the right people. The right people according to our values, the right fit. That's not all, of course. You get them on board. You get the right people. What do we do afterwards? We really have some very clear rules. Every month, the teams get together and talk about lots of things, of course, their business practices, etc., etc., but also about books. 1, 2, 3 people present a book that they've read to their colleagues. They do a little public speaking. It's not easy. Another very important, perhaps the most important rule is that every 6 months when you have the performance review, every company, every big company has it, and sometimes it can be very serious. In our case, it's very serious. But almost half of it, we are not talking about the numbers, we are not talking about the business side, we are talking about the person, about its personal growth, and about books. Another thing, and this is a crucial part, is that we managed to find a system, actually an IT system, to help us put in practice these ideas. Actually, we, like every company, like every big company, we have a CRM. You know what a CRM is, something with the customers, the financial IT tool. And this, most CRMs have a feedback module. So you send feedback, automatic emails to your company, to your customers to see what they are thinking of your services. Actually, what we did, we took this CRM and we reversed it to ourselves, outside in, let's say. So we are actually using for several projects the CRM to have a system of actually assessing who is reading, what is reading, small reviews, and all that. There are several aspects. It's not appropriate to get into all the details in a short presentation. I would be glad to explain it afterwards individually if you want. But the most important thing about this is what this allowed us to do. And another side remark. You all know, I'm sure you all know Warren Buffett, or you've heard of him. He's probably the biggest investor of all time. That's what they say. What few people know actually, or not most people know, is what he's actually doing at work every day. Most of the time he spends reading. Of course, some financial reports, etc., etc. But a lot of his actual work time is about reading books, relevant books to his activities, but not only specialty books. His partner, Charlie Munger, at least as strong as him. These guys, they are more than 80 years old, both, okay? This guy, he's at least as good as Warren Buffett, and he said, also a big reader, and he said that he has met, of course, he has met a lot of successful people, tremendously successful people. But he said recently in an article that he has not met one single very successful person in their field of activity who was not a heavy reader. According to him, a heavy reader is somebody that reads at least 3 hours each day. Okay, that's his standard. What's the message out of this? It's not, of course, that we should all read 3, 4, 5 hours a day. It would be nice. You also have to organize and to create a habit about it. That's what we try to do with our co-workers, because it's about creating a habit. We said to them, even if you are the slowest reader out there, with 15 minutes each day, you can easily read a book, a big book, each month. That's the minimum. And actually this minimum is being put into practice in our company. More than at least 2,000 books are being read each year. Just imagine the knowledge. And of course with a system to put it into practice. The main idea out of all this is that in order to grow a company through good and bad times, you really, really, really need to focus constantly on growing your people. Thank you very much.
Aș vrea să vă clarific rolul meu aici în fața voastră. Am spus puțin ideea de facilitare. Rolul meu este să creez un studiu de caz real pe ceea ce s-a întâmplat. Să extragem împreună niște idei care vă pot fi vouă utile și în alte contexte. O idee cheie pe care aș vrea să mă axez aici la speech-ul lui Dan este ideea cuvintelor. Cuvintele au mare putere. Și haideți să demitizăm un pic o statistică pe care sunt convins că toți o știți. 5% din mesaj este dat de cuvinte, 25% de paraverbal și 70% de non-verbal. Cifrele variază, dar non-verbalul e foarte mare, verbalul e foarte mic. Știți statistica asta? Ați auzit-o vreodată?
Da.
E falsă. Sau este incompletă, mai exact. Statistica este reală, în contextul în care există un conflict între ceea ce spui și paraverbalul tău sau non-verbalul tău. Deci, să dau un exemplu extrem. Nu știu, poate filmul Psycho cu Jack Nicholson, avea o față simpatică. Vine cuțitul la tantia și te iubesc, urlând. E posibil ca doamna aia să nu creadă cuvintele lui, ci cuțitul și vocea care urlă și să fugă. Adică sunt 95% șanse. Conform statisticii, 5% vor zice, ai, ce drăguț. Dar, mă rog, deci ideea este că dacă există un conflict între cele două, între non-verbal și partea de verbal, inevitabil vei crede non-verbal. Atât. În rest, când comunicăm cu oamenii, nu putem spune cuvintele nu au un impact. Un impact foarte mare. Și să dau un exemplu din Speakers Arena. Noi ne dorim aici să creăm o atmosferă plăcută, prietenoasă, safe. Și pentru asta, la început, eu sau cine m-a moderat între timp evenimentul, avea nevoie să spună câteva lucruri, să creeze această atmosferă. Și cum o creezi? Efectiv folosind niște cuvinte și lăsându-le acolo să plutească în atmosferă și oamenii să le ia dacă doresc, dacă nu, să existe așa în mentalul lor. Ei, am folosit cuvinte de genul o domnișoară care a moderat și era destul de înspăimântată de ideea de a modera și din păcate nu era foarte pregătită, folosi cuvinte de genul nu vă fie frică! Nu dă nimeni cu roșii în voi! Nu o să pățiți nimic! Eram pe scaun, la câțiva metri de ea și tremuram de frică și mă gândeam, Dumnezeule, e proiectul meu, de ce mi-e frică? Cuvintele sunt puternice. Aveți mare grijă la ce cuvinte folosiți și cum le folosiți. Și vreau să dau un singur exemplu din ce a spus Dan. O legătură care a făcut-o între idei. We can talk about strategies, blah, 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 these are not important, what important is this. Toate sunt importante. Toate sunt importante și în loc să zici this is not important, poți foarte bine să spui, but I don't want to focus on this. Nu vreau să mă concentrez pe asta, vreau să mă axez, să mă concentrez pe următoarele idei. Dar aveți mare, mare grijă să nu vă faultați singur niște idei, doar fiindcă nu vreți să le acordați timp acum. Și idei care voi considerați că sunt importante, dar vreți să vorbiți despre altceva. Să nu le negați.
Și aveți mare grijă, fiindcă e o greșeală pe care o văd foarte des la mulți oameni, să se concentreze pe niște lucruri și celelalte să le considere mai puțin importante. Și pe de-o parte, cum a spus și Mircea, vorbești mai repede, că nu sunt importante. Hai să trec repede de asta, să ajung la ceea ce vreau să vă spun cu adevărat. Pe de altă parte, vă spun să faci niște tranziții între idei, care cumva să diminueze impactul acelor idei pe care le-ai avut. Dacă nu se merită spusă o idee, nu o integra în speech-ul tău. Dacă se merită spusă atunci, spune-o și dă-i ocazia să ajungă la oamenii aia și concentrează-te pe alte idei, dar fără să le diminuezi pe celelalte. Asta v-aș sugera pe viitor, când aveți ocazia să vorbiți în public sau chiar și într-o discuție mai importantă cu un șef, un public de unul, dar un public important, alegeți-vă bine cuvintele și frazarea. Și puteți face asta dacă repetați. E vitală repetiția în acest proces, fiindcă ideile sunt clare în cap, dar în momentul în care le scoți, elementul ăsta mic de legătură între două idei s-ar putea să scadă impactul pe care îl ai. Vă mulțumesc mult!